Monday, October the 18th of my practice diary. I've done the most weirdest thing just now. And I was well set in on talking to the camera and noticed that the iPad went dull and I hadn't pressed the record button. So it just shows today is a distracted day. So you notice it's not going to be getting lighter behind me. It's going to be getting darker. I'm at my practice later on in the day today. I'm recognising, I mentioned last week that I'm waiting for some medical news in terms of I'm going to have surgery, and it looks like the surgery will be next week. It's of a brain nature, which sounds rather terrifying, but actually of brain things, this is the best one to have. So I'm having to sort of do a lot this week in terms of making sure I get everything ready so that actually while I'm away and recovering, that everything is in place. I feel the responsibility, certainly not heavily, I was going to say, but I feel the responsibility keenly, I think is a better word, for the composers and two recordings that are just nearly coming through, and also various other projects, OPC, which is progressing really well, and we've got sort of certain targets that are coming. So there's a lot to do, but I found myself wondering, am I going to do the website? It got to this point in the day. Shall I do the website or shall I practice? And I realised that if I started the website, practice would go to the dogs. And I don't want that to happen. Firstly, because I didn't want that to happen. And, you know, I'm back to a really, really nice routine, despite sometimes having resistance or whatever. It wasn't today. Today was absolutely, like yesterday, actually, very much wanting to practice. Not least because practice will once again be disrupted once they do whatever they do. It might be surgery, it might be another form of getting rid of what's there. But anyway, we shall, I'm wanting to sort of prepare so that everything is ready. So I've kind of been a bit more flexible with my practice. And I asked myself, am I losing the discipline, because I've always been very kind of I will practice at this time, and in a sense being quite rigid, and I always saw that as actually a good, you know, a positive thing of controlling what I do. And I think for some to actually set a practice time, particularly if you've got a sort of a day that has a routine, particularly if you work away from home or whatever, that it can, you know, procrastinating as to when to practice can be really irksome. And I do love to practice first thing in the morning. First of all, the room is cold and I never like practicing in a cold room. It's not good for my hands. It's not good for the reed. It's not good for the clarinet. So by this point, my lovely oil-filled radiator has warmed the room up nice and toastily. So by this time in the day, the room is warm and therefore my practice will be more comfortable. But also, if I'm too distracted with the many tasks that I have to do, that for me is going to be a distraction and obstruct my practice. So I'm accepting to be a little bit flexible at the moment in terms of when I do my practice. But when I know that to do practice after supper is just not going to happen. While my supper is a very movable feast, get much past 8 o'clock and it gets more of a struggle to make sure I do the practice with the mindset that I want to do it with. So that's how I've had certain distractions today. I had the terrible news, very sudden death of Alexander Hunfeld, who was one of our composers that we publish, Dutch composer. I've been closely in touch with him. We've had many Zooms. We've never actually met in person, but we've talked so much and extensively, and his lovely works that he's so far published with us. And he was going to start writing me. He even told me the name of it, which I can't quite remember, a solo clarinet piece, and we had many projects in mind. So that was deeply, deeply upsetting and very sudden. So I sort of had to take myself away from the room just to reflect. So it took a small chunk out of the day just to, well, I'm still processing it actually. So anyway, back to it and more tasks done. And it got to the point on my day where it was a fork in the road. Shall I do the website? Shall I practice? And I'm happy to say practice did win. So I've already, it's second day read, so I've not done my scales because I don't want to go up high. Tomorrow I will. It's a much more promising read. I spoke yesterday about bottom notes and how I'm sort of, you know, how we kind of choose the read and how we know how the read will progress. I forgot the word which I wanted to use was like a pixelated picture. So at the bottom, it can feel like a bit like a like you're hearing the individual tones, like a pixelated picture, basically. And I knew that it was starting to come together even when once I stopped filming. This read is definitely progressing in the way that I want. It's so nice that it's not overly hard, but it's got what I want. So so I've progressed onto another read, and for a change, I don't always do that. My old read is still usable, but now that this one has worked well in, we've made the progression without my feeling that I have no read at all. So I've spoken, I think, a little bit about these velocity exercises. My concern at the moment, because of what's going on up there, is cognition. I'm being quite pragmatic about it most of the time, and I'm being very watchful about how instruction is feeding to fingers. It's something I do anyway, but because with everything that's going on, I'm acutely aware that I'm not noticing any sudden or desperate changes, which obviously if I did, I would flag up very, very quickly with the medical side, because that shows that something, that it's shifting again and something needs to be done. So I think being sort of cognitively quite aware of what's going on makes me feel that I'm not concerned, certainly in the short term, about what's happening. I did ask the GP whether it's okay to play, and she's came back with if you don't feel badly while playing, then play. So that's good advice. And of course, I remember that very question coming up in the Masters, the Performance Science Masters. So it's quite interesting that in that situation, I find myself needing to be reminded of that. So these velocity, they're really great. I will often do them with a metronome. I've no idea how a metronome comes up with recording. Perhaps I should experiment with it. I put it on generally, gosh, I can barely see what I'm doing here because it's quite dark. I put it, this one on, it's number 18 of the velocity. I always forget which book it is. It's the advanced. They're really, really great, and I can always put the details of it up. They're fantastic exercises. I've mentioned them before. And I think this time I'm going to do it. Well, I'm normally between 120 and 126. I think I'm going to do 126. And I'm just going to... And I'm going to just check 120. Sometimes I make sure I do it a little slowly because it's nice to really process. It's about process. It's always about where we want to look and where the information is passing. It's a little bit like when Billy Eliot, in that wonderful film, which I absolutely adore, and he's learning to do a pirouette. And at first, I don't know those of you who've seen it, and at first he keeps falling over, he keeps getting dizzy. And I think us playing fast is really like that, although thankfully not literally doing a pirouette, but that we need to know where we're looking, because we're actually, our fingers are moving faster than we can process, and we've got to grab that. And to me, this one is all about that. So I'm just going to do a little bit of number 18. We'll just see what it feels like. I'm going to set the metronome. I've no idea how it'll come out on this, but you know, this is a snapshot of my practice, and that's what I do in my practice. Yes, I am noticing that I'm breathing more often. I'm trying to alleviate pressure from my brain, and so I'm not going to cause problems because I want to carry on practicing. So absolutely fantastic exercises, and I'm very aware of where I'm looking and the shape of the fingers, particularly at the bottom hand when they go sort of at the bottom there. And I notice how if I look in the right place, it kind of stabilizes and gets my head where I need to be. So, you know, when things go wrong, like they have a few days ago and in front of the camera, we learn as much when things go wrong as hopefully when things go as we had wanted, and various versions of that. So, and then once we have the instruction that we know where to look, or you know, whether we need to feel it or what particular instruction that we need to give, then we're not playing Russian roulette. It's a planned, it's a very precise, and then that leaves us room to think about tone and other things. Anyway, I'm going to finish this off and finish off the rest of my practice.